Dr. Gupta and friends, I deem it a privilege to exchange ideas with this learned group. The topic that I have chosen is because I am a student of philosophy, and therefore I thought that I should put an Indian mode of philosophizing in its proper perspective. Though though a cognitive enterprise does not strictly admit of geographical boundaries, yet there is something distinctive in each cultural ambience which provides a distinctive character to the mode of thinking of that particular area. This has been the case with India as well. In the Greek tradition, philosophy was regarded as love of wisdom. And it was more or less a sort of, you can say, speculative enterprise. And an intellectual, you can say, discipline. But in India, philosophy, known as darshana, was regarded as a love for life lived in wisdom. Not just a love for wisdom, but love for a life lived in wisdom. And therefore, it had, of course, a theoretical foundation, a very strong theoretical foundation, but also had a practical overtone. To philosophize is to reflect upon our lived experiences, problematic experiences, experiences which demand a concrete solution. And it is a systematic reflection, not a hodgepodge of ideas. And therefore, a very solid epistemological and logical foundation was provided to philosophy. So it was a critical reflection upon our lived experiences with a view to be benefited therefrom. That means philosophizing, not for sake of philosophizing, but to realize something, to achieve something. There is always, this is insisted, that there must be a prayojana, something to be acquired through philosophy. That means philosophy, therefore, has to be of concrete use too in our day-to-day living. So this is what is known as darshana. Literally, darshana means to see as it is. To see what? To see the reality within, the reality outside, and perhaps the underlying reality, which may be transcendental. So to see the reality as it is, to view the reality as it is. Technically, we call it as iksha. Iksha means sakshatkara, to view the reality as it is, without being distorted, mutilated by any external conditions. So, other term that we use for this is aparokshanubhuti. Paroksha means indirect, and aparoksha means direct, direct realization, intuitive apprehension of the nature of reality. This is technically known as a iksha. Well, we have, nature has endowed us with this capacity to undergo experiences and to approach reality as it is. But sometimes, because of external conditioning, we may not view the reality as it is, different from what it is. Always there is a possibility of error, possibility of deviation or distortion. Distortion could be due to many factors. Maybe because of, since we may approach the reality to our cognitive senses, and senses may err, senses may be defective. And therefore, there can be error in our direct apprehension of the nature of reality. And therefore, this requires a critical understanding, a sort of an examination. So every ikra, we have been told by our ancestors, that should be followed by anviksha, anu ikra, a critical analysis of the experiences that we acquire of the reality. Every experience is experience of something which is there. Experience of reality, not something which is hypostatized as something which is a sort of a projection of the mind, imagination. Well, to ponder over imaginations are unreal is not philosophy. Philosophy is concerned only with our analysis of experiences of reality, that which exists, which we call as sat or satta. So that which existed in the past, that we exist in the present, or that which may exist in the future. But it has to have existence, actual or potential. So every experience which is an object of philosophizing must be real or genuine experience, and problematic in the sense that it makes us to think as to what is that experience, how it has arisen, what far it has arisen, and what could be its utility for our betterment of living. That means philosophy is not purposeless or aimless. It must have a clear and consistent objective to reflect on. So every iksha has to be followed by anu iksha. Anu means that which comes after, anviksha. Well, this is undertaken by the cognizer himself or herself. I undergo experiences and I reflect upon my own experiences. And for that, I must take into account what is known as rules of reasoning, rules of reflection, so that I may not go astray in my analysis. This anviksha is again to be followed by pariksha, wherein we take help of others' viewpoints. Because there should not be, in a good philosophical analysis, there should not be subjectivity. It has to be objective, such that the reflections and the solutions we arrive at can be universalized. And therefore, it has to be examined thoroughly, which we call as a pariksha. Pari means in totality. Pari samanta means in totality. So, iksha, anviksha, and pariksha, these are the three stages of philosophizing in Indian context. So it's not merely a theoretical enterprise. Now, this exercise, of course, it is an intellectual exercise. It's a thought enterprise. But we undertake a holistic view and an integrated understanding. We reflect upon the total reality. Of course, reality is manifold, multifarious, and you may approach reality in different parts also. But then we have to have a holistic picture of the total reality. In the West, the mode of thinking was always compartmentalized. Right from the, Plato, a distinction was drawn between the archetype and the ichetype, the form and the matter. This was further crystallized by Aristotle. And it's a very radical formulation you find in Cartesian dualism between distinction, radical distinction between mind and matter. But in India, the approach was holistic. Thank you. I don't take this. We say that a reality is at once both centripetal and centrifugal. From one issues forth the multiple. Ultimate reality is unitary, and we say it is consciousness. Fundamental reality is unitary consciousness, not matter. The matter is also to be known through consciousness only. Consciousness can know itself, but matter can't know itself. Matter, therefore, is derivative and consciousness is a fundamental. We have a good deal of arguments to prove the primacy and supremacy of consciousness over matter. And for us, matter is only an epiphenomenon of consciousness. But this apart, the ultimate reality is one unitary whole. The Nasadi Sukta of the Rig Veda says, Anidvatam Sodayakta Dekam Ek. And one becomes many. Ekoham Bahusya. One becomes multiple. From one source, the entire multiplicity comes into existence. And the entire multiplicity is sustained by that unitary foundational principle. It is enlivened by that unitary foundational principle. And this entire multiplicity may go back to the common source. Technically, we call it as a avyakta adini bhutani vyakta badhyani cha bharata avyakta nidhanneva. The ultimate reality is unmanifest in the beginning, then gets manifested, but again returns back to that unmanifested nature, which means that from one you have the multiplicity. This is a centrifugal approach to reality, and the multiplicity comes back ultimately in one. Well, this is the understanding of quantum physics as well in modern times, that you have one funding source from which the multiplicity arises. And therefore, there is a fundamental unity of all existences. In ultimate analysis, all existences share the same essence. And that is consciousness or quantas. Now, we have therefore a whole and parts. The ultimate reality is a unitary whole, of which the entire multiplicity constitutes the parts. And the relation between the whole and the parts is that of reciprocity. Perfect symmetry, perfect compatibility, which means that therefore we say yatha pinde tatha brahmande. The microcosm and the macrocosm have the same essence, and therefore in the universe there is no disharmony. The cosmic process is very much orderly. It abides by what we may call these days as law of causation. Ancient Vedic rishis used the word rita for that. This is ritambara. But we human beings who are a product of the cosmic process have the unfortunate capacity to introduce disharmony. In nature, there is no disharmony. nature is always lawful. We human beings introduce lawlessness, and all ecological imbalance that we experience is human making. It's not nature making. Anyway, there's another point. The point is this, that this whole cosmos is organic in nature. In an organism, you have one whole organism in which you have multiple parts. Every part has its own specific location in the total organism. Every part has its own particular function in the total organism. Functions within the organism for the sake of organism, not for its own sake, and contributes to the total well-being of the organism. And in the total well-being of the organism lies the well-being of each and every part. If an organism is sick, every part also will experience that sort of sickness or disease. If an organism is at ease, then there is no disease. So this is the approach to reality that has been envisioned by the Vedic seers, and that has percolated down up to the modern times. In this, we have experience of the unity, the total organism. We also have the experiences of multiplicity within the unity. So, unity in multiplicity and multiplicity in unity. We use an expression, one is in all and all is in one. This sort of approach has been inculcated by our ancient sages and seers. So, here, in this sort of understanding, what we find is that differences are there, but there are no divisions. Difference, there is a difference between this hand and this hand, a hand and a leg, or a leg and the eyes and ears, and every part has its own distinct existence. So differences are there, but there are no divisions. The hand doesn't exist in itself, by itself, for itself. And if it is cut off, then it's no longer alive, it is dead. So its existence, its survival lies in being in the totality. Same is the case with this cosmos. This cosmos, therefore, is a very intricate unity of interdependent parts. You are having this sort of conference or seminar, Vasudeva Kutumbakam. In the front gate of our parliament, we have Ayam Nijah Paroveti Ganana Laguchetasam Udara Charitanam Tu Vasudeva Kutumbakam. This is there in the front gate of our parliament, from which you have borrowed this caption. Ayam Nijah Paro. This is mine, this is yours. This sort of a division, I and thou. Well, it is garna lagu. It's an attitude of a person with mean mentality. I am nijah paroveti garna lagu cheta. Lagu cheta means one who has a very narrow perception,
low level
thinking. Udhar charita, one who has a liberal attitude. Udhar charita anto vasudhaiva kutumbakam. Whole universe is one single family. One single family. In a family, differences are there. Differences are there between parents and children and grandchildren and so forth. Yet the family is one. There is some sort of solidarity in the family. And of course, differences might be there, but they should not result into disputes. Well, this is what we have been enjoined by our sages and seers. Homogeneity should be there in the family. So, orderliness should be there, some sort of discipline should be there, and therefore we have rules for what may be called as harmonious living. We have three rules for harmonious living, which is which are being advocated. One is peaceful coexistence, sahavas, shanti maya sahavas. Saha means together, vas means to live together. In fact, this is not only for a family, it can be enlarged for the society and for the nation and the, for the universal literature. So, sahavas. Sahana vavatu, sahano bhunaktu, sahaviryam karvava. This is a very famous invocation verse from the Upanishads. So, we have to have a sahavas, togetherness in living. We have to live perforce together. We can't lead a life of a Robinson Crusoe. We have to live together, and therefore we have to depend upon others. This cosmos is an interplay of interdependent existences. In fact, there is a very famous doctrine propounded by Lord Buddha. It's known as Pratitya Samutpada, the doctrine of a dependent origination and interdependent existence. In this cosmos, nothing exists in itself, by itself, for itself. Everything has a causal origin, the dependent existence. Given the cause, you have the effect. Everything that we experience in the world is having a causal preceding conditions. So given the cause, you have the effect. If you have good causal conditions, then you have good effects. If you have evil causal conditions, then you will have evil effects. So this sort of Buddha also called it karma, doctrine of karma. And therefore, there has to be some sort of reciprocity in our living. This is the first condition that they have enshrined. The second one is, if we have to live together peacefully, then we also have to work together, sahakar. Savirjam karvavahe. We have to work together. We have to work to live. No living being can exist without work. Even a small insect has to work for livelihood. Has to move around for getting food. So we have to work. But what sort of work we should have? It has to be cooperative work. Because you can't do everything for yourself, by yourself. There is division of labor. For example, we had this Varna Vyavastha in good old days, not the present caste system. But the Varna Vyavastha was the division of work. There are multiple professions which we require to undertake, and one can't be expert in all the professions, so there has to be division of work. And therefore we had this fourfold, but it could be eightfold or hundredfold, whatever be the number. But the point is that there has to be division of work, and there has to be cooperative enterprise. So sahaviryam karvavahe, we should work together, cooperative enterprise. And in order to have successful cooperative enterprise, there are four stages which are prescribed. Well, what should be the goal of our activity? By far should we act? What should be the objective of our activities, our conduct? In a human being, if it is a rational, willful activity, we call it as a conductor. Not mere action, but conduct. Conduct is a technical term that we use. Achar. So we have to be very clear about the objective of our activity. And since the activity is for not only for survival, but also for quality of life. And quality of life is both material as well as spiritual. Material prosperity as well as spiritual enhancement. And therefore, a clear distinction is drawn in our tradition between prayers and shreyas. Prayers is for material prosperity. Prayers stands for well-being of body, well-being of the vital breaths, well-being of the mind, well-being of the intellect. We call it as annamaya kosha, pranamaya kosha, manomaya kosha, and vijnanamaya kosha. Well-being, all actions which are collective and corporate should be for well-being of all these four material dimensions. In Vedas, you have prayers addressed to the divine beings, and the divine beings are natural phenomena, Agni, Varuna, etc. They are personalized natural phenomena. Prayers are offered to them so that, for example, they say to Varuna that there should be good rains so that there is good harvest, so that our cows can graze green grass. Well, prayer for the health of the body. And body can be healthy if the atmosphere is also with the pure air. So prana, that is also equally needed. How there should not be any environmental pollution. Water should not be made polluted. Earth should not be polluted. Air should not be polluted. Fire should not be polluted. Well, we have to worship them. To worship them is only a sort of a pretext to protect their purity. We regard earth as a mother. Prithvi Devi Namastubhyam Padasparsho Samakshome. Well, with our feet, we should not pollute the earth. And suppose by any mistake or by chance we do so, then we have to beg pardon. So we worship not only earth, we worship plants, we worship animals. Yeah, lion is worshipped. Lion is regarded as a vahana of some gods. Why? Because every iota of the cosmos has some purpose to serve. Nothing is useless in this world. We have to know what purpose it can serve and how best we can make use of that purpose. Therefore, the idea was that, why far should we act? We should act for sake of material prosperity. India was very rich in material prosperity in good old days. And that's why foreign invaders came here to loot. Had there been no property, they would not have come for looting purpose. No? India was very much skillful in say trade and industry. Well, your second part is about Indian culture in Asian countries and other places, which is because of trade that merchants went there. This is a historical record. Merchants went there along with the goods, ideas also spread there. So, we must therefore take care of prayers. But mere material prosperity is not enough. Side by side, there should also be spiritual enhancement. And Shreyas, therefore, was also equally emphasized. Isavarshopanishad, one of the very important Upanishads, says that Vidya and Avidya, both Sambhuti and Asambhuti, should go together. Because if we do not care for spiritual enhancement, material prosperity will result in exploitation, in competitiveness, in injustice. And this is what we are witnessing when we have borrowed the Western mode of what can be called as economics, Western mode of economic planning. I will refer to that subsequently also. So my point, therefore, is that if we have to act, and we have to act in a corporate manner, then we should act both for material prosperity as also for spiritual enhancement. But then, this is what we call as the end, the goal, the sadhya. But for realizing the sadhya, there must be sadhana, means which are conducive, not detrimental, conducive to the realization of the goal. Chanakya or Kautilya in his Arthashastra has discussed what should be the goal. It is happiness. Happiness is the samambonam of life. Parja sukhe sukham ragya. The happiness of a ruler lies, or a leader lies, only in the happiness of the people. Well, this is a lesson which our present day leader should be taught. I think we should have one seminar on Arthashastra of Kautilya. It is a marvelous work of social, political, economic, and international organization. Kautilya has discussed all facets of human life and human existence, and therefore he has talked of the sadhya, then the sadhana, the means. And the means should be not only conducive to the realization of the goal, means should also be available. Means should not be mere speculations, wishful thinking. They must be available in the given situation. And not only they should be available, they should be accessible. And they should be accessible to each and all. Education is a means, but education must be accessible to everyone. This, when we talk of right to education, well, it is because of this purpose only. It should be accessible to everyone. So that because everyone has the potential to act. Everyone has to act, and everyone can act in a better way for the betterment of the entire society and the cosmos at large. So means should be available and accessible, which means we must have the proper skill. In Bhagavad Gita, we call it yoga. Yoga karmasu kaushalam. What is yoga? Yoga is nothing but a skillfulness, kaushal. We use the word kushal also, kushalta, kaushalya. So the means should be available and accessible. And means might be available, means might be accessible, but if we do not give proper training as to how to make use of those means, because the means that we have to employ may have different stages of operation. First you undertake this, then this, then this, then this. Education, for example, it has to be in stages. If you have to impart education, then two sort of orders have to be kept in mind. One is the logical order of the instructional material, and another is the psychological order of the learner. If you don't take care of the two orders, logical and the psychological, the whole entire scheme of education will be fruitless. In fact, at present, this is the unfortunate situation obtaining in our country and also the world at large. Therefore, technically, we call it modalities. Iti kartavyata. We have sadhya, we have sadhana, we have iti kartavyatas. And when we strictly adhere to these three stages, then you have really a desirable outcome, follow the result. So these are the guidelines for a collective enterprise, sahakara. We talked of sahavasa, then we talked of sahakara, and the third one is sahabhoga, which is very important in Indian culture. Sahabhoga means mutual caring and sharing. Enjoying the fruits collectively, distributively. In the Rig Veda, it has been stated, kevaladau kevalagi bhavati. One who eats by one's own self depriving others is the greatest sinner. It's a sin just to enjoy one's own and not to allow others to enjoy. Means whatever be the opportunities, well, they should be equally be made available to each and every. This is what we call as social justice also. This is in terms of Mahatma Gandhi and Dindyal Upadhyay, called Antyodaya, unto the last. Everyone should be benefited by our collective enterprise. No one should be deprived. And when we say no one should be deprived, it should be not only intra-generational justice, justice in the same generation. It should also be intergenerational justice. We have to care for our future generations as well, because natural resources are exhaustible. And if they are exhausted, and if we do not develop the alternative source of natural resources, we shall be depriving the posterity. And I am reminded of one advertisement that appears on TV. One small child tells his father that I will, when I grow up, I will open up a cycle repair shop. And the father asks, why? Because you know, this petrol and petroleum products will all be exhausted, and then we shall have to depend upon cycle. Anyway, we have many such stories and parables to care for the posterity. So intergenerational justice also has to be taken into account. These are, the ways in which there has to be a holistic understanding of the nature of reality, the nature of our existence, not only human existence, but all existences. Our ancestors have also told us two things. Every existence has a intrinsic worth and instrumental value. Intrinsic worth means it has its own value. And we should be aware of its intrinsic worth, and we should care for that intrinsic worth, protect the intrinsic worth of each and every existence. Every existence has its own swabhava, and we should not pollute or destroy or disturb that swabhava of every existence. Say for water. Water has its own swabhava, and we should not therefore pollute. If you pollute the swabhava of water, naturally the evil consequences will follow. So every existence, a plant, a tree, everything, even in, say, lion, tigers, they also have swabhava. We have to protect them. These days we do talk of animal rights, and we are also talking of rights of nature. So we therefore should know the swabhava of each and every existence, and every existence has instrumental value apart from intrinsic worth. It serves, every existence serves itself and also others. Everything can be made use of, provided we have judicious understanding of its instrumentality. If we, science for example, can be a boon and a bane. Why? Because it has the capacity to help us if it is properly used, harm us also if it is improperly used. And therefore, we must know not only the intrinsic worth of each and every existence, but also the instrumental value. In what way every existence can be helpful to us, instrumental to our well-being. And well-being of every existence contributes to the well-being of the totality. And in the well-being of the totality lies the well-being of every individual existence. So this is the holistic approach that has been inculcated in Indian mode of philosophizing. Unfortunately, we are not conscious of it, we are not aware of it, and we do not practice. We used to practice, it seems, in good old days, but now we don't do that. In Indian mode of philosophizing, we regard reality as unitary as well as multiple. And to begin with, we have to take cognizance of the multiplicity and then look for the fundamental unity. We begin with multiplicity in our empirical existence and then come to the unity. So multiplicity is to be recognized. Multiplicity provides richness to cosmic life. We should not negate the multiplicity. We should not negate the worldly life of multiplicity. Worldly life of multiplicity means multiple relations are there, multiple existences are there, multiple vocations are there, multiple social formations are there. Everything has its own value, but we should recognize its value. And not only we should recognize, this multiplicity can be enhanced. And therefore, we must enhance the potentiality of the multiplicity. To give just one example, we have been told, we are Amritasya Putraha. This is another famous statement from the Rig Veda. We are the progeny of the infinite. Which means, though we presently we are finite, but we have tremendous capacities and capabilities to multiply ourselves, to make ourselves perfect. We have been further told that from perfection we have come, we are perfect, and we have to go back to perfection. Om Purnaha, Purnamadaha, Purnata, Purnasamujyate, Purnasya Purnamadaya. So from infinity we have come and we have to go back to infinity. Means we have the potentiality. And this is how our mind, for example, you have explosion of knowledge. We are increasing our cognitive capacity day by day. And there is no end to that. We can go on multiplying our cognitive capacity. We have the capacity not only to undergo experiences, but also to enlarge our experiences, to heighten our experiences, to deepen our experiences. We have that capacity. The human beings have this, that animals may not have to that extent because we are the highest evolute in the cosmic process. But since we are the highest evolute, we are the most responsible person and we have to be most responsible. We have to be responsible. And therefore, in Indian culture, we don't have any word called rights. We don't have any rights. We have only obligations. The word right does not occur in our literature, ancient literature. Only now, in vernaculars, the word adhikar is being used. Well, the word adhikar is never used in Sanskrit, classical Sanskrit, for sake of what you call as rights. What we have is only Pancha Mahayagyas, Bhuta Yagya, Pitru Yagya, Atiti Yagya, Deva Yagya, Brahma Yagya. Yagya means whatever labor, whatever activity you undertake, it should be for the sake of others. You first renounce it to others and then you enjoy it. So famous statement from Isha Vashyopanishad, which most of us must be knowing, is a Kurvaniya Karmani. We should do work in the cosmos. We should never remain inactive. But he says that tena taktena bhunjitaha. You, whatever result that accrue from your enterprises, you enjoy it first before renouncing. Taktena bhunjita. First tyaga and then bhoga. Not that first bhoga and then tyaga. Not that first you enjoy and residue you leave to others. No, first you renounce. That's why while eating also, we have this ritual, that we take out some pieces for animals or others. No? So first you must renounce and then enjoy. Not that you enjoy and then residue. This is what Kevalagi Bhauti Vidhika says, that if you enjoy it by yourself only, you are the greatest sinner. So yajna was performed. Yajna, of course, now yajna is a ritual, and we have distorted the meaning of yajna. That was not the meaning in the Vedic times. Now you have an altar and you put wood, a light fire, pour ghee and things like that. Well, that is not the yajna in the Vedic context. This is Puranic understanding of yajna, which is a misunderstanding of yajna. Yajna stands for a collective enterprise in which you will have four or five different partners. Symbolically, we have four, Rik, Yajus, Sam and Atharva, and a Purohita and Yajamana. Well, means it is collective enterprise. And there, very interestingly, it is said while doing Ahutis, we say, Idam Namama. It's not for me. The yajna that I'm performing is not for my sake. It's not for my well-being. It's not for my enjoyment. Idam na mama. Idam means this. Nam is not. Mama means for me. Idam indraya swaha. I renounce is for the totality. In the sense for totality. This is the actual meaning of the word yajna. To act collectively and to enjoy distributively. So we have Pancha Mahayagyas. Bhuta means for the all existences. We should care for all existences. We should so act as not to destroy any existence. Of course, we cannot destroy. We don't have that capacity to destroy. But we can pollute. So we should not pollute any existence. Bhuta Yajna. Bhuta means all existences. Pitru Yajna, respect for parents, elderly people. Parents may be in large elderly persons. Well, we had respect for the elderly. In the Taittiriya Upanishad, in the convocation address, it says, Matra Devo Bhava, Pitra Devo Bhava, let mother be the goddess, let father be the god. Means they are worshipful people, elderly people. Therefore, we must pay due respect to the elderly people. And of course, these use the word senior citizens. So they are all pitras only. Then is Mahapitra Devo, Acharya Devo Bhava. And then third is Atithi Yajna. So, we should say those who come to seek assistance, to help, we should give help to them. Atithi does not mean merely anyone who comes as a guest. No, it is anyone who is needy. We have to reinterpret our classical words and give them new connotations also. So, Atithi means whosoever is needed our help, we should offer help. We should seek help. We should also give help, Atithi Yajna. And then Deva Yajna, the natural forces. We have to see to it that balance is maintained there and they are helpful to us. They do not turn out to be harmful to us. And Brahma Yajna. Brahma stands for totality. We should care for the totality. And if you care for the totality, every part will be ipso facto taken care of. This sort of approach was there in our mode of philosophizing. So this is the concept of yajna. We have the concept of rinas also. Again, obligations. Yajnas and rinas and no rights. We have to perform karma. every karma will have its own consequence. But Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita that we should not bother for the consequence. We should only bother for the performance of the karma. Karma we have to perform. Sorry. Hello? I may be seminar. Now, in our Indian mode of philosophizing, we make it very clear that we have to begin with knowledge. Knowledge is the first prerequisite. In Gita, it is called as Jnana Marga. Knowledge of our own self, our nature, our status in the cosmos, our potentialities, our duties pertaining to the station of our life, this all knowledge has to be there. Knowledge is the only means for realizing perfection. We put perfection. Perfection means happiness, plenitude, peace. Well, this is what we mean by perfection. So if you want peace, if you want happiness, then you must know what peace is and how to realize the peace. So knowledge. Rite jnanat na mukti. This is what we have been told. So knowledge is the paramount goal of our enterprise. Knowledge in its totality. And that's why in Indian mode of philosophizing, we have given details. What is knowledge? What is error? How to acquire knowledge? How to avoid error? We have different modes of knowing, like perception. Well, what is the nature of perception? What are perceptual error? Detailed analysis of perceptual error has been given. Perceptual error may be due to faulty functioning of the senses, maybe distortion by the mind, might be that the object is given in a particular situation where we cannot apprehend it as it is. For example, you are in a train. Your train is stationary. The adjacent train is moving, but the movement is transferred to your train. This is a perceptual error. In psychology, we have been told about perceptual error in textbooks also. Many such examples are there in psychology, we have been told. So we have to therefore take into account what is genuine perception and what are errors possible and what are the causes for those errors in perception. Similarly, we have large amount of our knowledge through inference. Entire scientific technological enterprise is based on inference only. Of course, we do have laboratory experiments where we have perception, but thereafter we derive conclusions. They are all inferential, whether deductive or inductive. There can be inferential fallacies. There are inferential fallacies. So we have detailed analysis running into hundreds of pages. Virtually hundreds of pages are there dealing with the inferential errors. We have a system called Nyaya Shastra. In Nyaya Shastra, we have, because every inferential judgment is called generalization, inductive generalization. And there are many inductive fallacies. So every induction is based on universalization, and there can be many fallacies of universalization. Virtually, we have thousands of pages, literally I'm saying thousands of pages lying in manuscripts dealing with the inferential errors. It is unfortunate that the language of Navya Nyaya is so terse and so much complicated that those crore patras, we call them as crore patras, they are lying in the libraries of Oriental institutes, but we are unable to make any headway into those Krodpatras. And of course, now thanks to our former Prime Minister Atal Bihari Vajpayee, now manuscripts are being collected and preserved. But only, I think, not more than 10% manuscripts have been collected and preserved. 90% are still there, and these are getting destroyed also. Many manuscripts are being sold out to Europeans because they are more interested than what we are. We do have a discipline called manuscriptology. But again, that manuscriptology is borrowed from the West. It doesn't help us to understand our Indian manuscripts. And many of these manuscripts are written in Brahmi script. We don't know now the Brahmi script. The script has become foreign to us. These are all what may be called as dark situations which we are facing these days. But anyway, the point is this, that we have perceptual errors, inferential errors, and then we depend upon scriptural testimony, verbal testimony. Even now, for example, I'm saying, well, I'm speaker, you are hearer. I say something, you interpret it. Well, everyone may interpret it in a different way. How can there be one common mode of interpretation? So that whatever I think is exactly communicated to you and is understood and interpreted by you. Modes of interpretation. Entire Vedanga, we have developed to understand the Vedic truths. Vedangas are there. And the Purva Mimamsa system has developed a detailed scheme of undertaking linguistic interpretation. Indian analysis of language has been very thorough. We have, of course, it is well known, Panini could give us a system of grammar which is most compact and most computer friendly as well. The best system available so far in the world. Now, this sort of linguistic analysis was given by our ancient thinkers. Because only through language we communicate knowledge, whether it is perceptual or inferential or any. So language is the only vehicle available to us. And if the language is not properly used, the whole purpose of communication is marred. And this is what has happened, in fact. We have different conditions under which different types of interpretations are to be given. I give you just one example. In the law courts, when judgments were to be delivered, the British judges, not the Indian ones, of course, now one or two Indian judges have taken interest, the British judges used to study Purva Mimamsa system and used to consult experts in Purva Mimamsa system for delivering judgments pertaining to Hindu society cases. And we have such judgments available to us now in writing. In English, they are also available. The point, therefore, is that linguistic analysis is very much important. And how we have to interpret in what sequence. Say, for example, if there is a negative injunction, a legal injunction can be positive, do's, and negative, don'ts. In a negative injunction, the negative particle, if it is associated with noun, it will have one meaning. If it is associated with pronoun, it will have another meaning. If it is associated with verb, it will have still another meaning. And these meanings are, say, laid down threadbare by the Purva Mimamsa systems. So, again, the point is this, that we don't have an approach to them, accessibility to them. We don't, because unfortunately, Purva Mimamsa was associated with rituals only, and the philosophical part of it has been forgotten. I don't want to go into details, but I would like to tell you one more thing, because you have time is coming up shortly. You made reference to applied philosophy. Indian mode of philosophizing is not merely theoretical. It has a very deep and I should say a very vast application as well. Philosophy has been applied for social organization, and within social organization, organization of the individual life, family life, community life, national life, and international life. So individual transformation. And for that, we have samskaras. Soda samskaras are there. 16 what call sacraments, you may call it in English, following the Christian terminology. I think we are familiar with samskaras, but some of the samskaras we still observe, like say, while birth of a child, we observe, or marriage we have, and many other things. How individual life should be developed, both materially, intellectually, and spiritually, that has been taken care of in the Dharma Shastras. Dharma Shastra, therefore, provides us that philosophical background. If you read Rig Veda, there is one hymn called Surya Hymn, where the father gives a departing lesson to the daughter after marriage, that how she should behave in the family of the bride, I'm sorry, bridegroom. Very detailed analysis is there. These days we talk of women's empowerment, etc., etc. I think these people who are talking of women, they should read the Surya hymns of the Rig Veda. What sort of advice father gives? And if that is followed, then all these problems which are arising these days of dowry and other things will not come into existence. Or female, the fetus being killed, etc. How we should respect all the family members, including one's own self. That is propounded there. Of course, we are familiar with this. Samvadatam, Samgachatam, Samvu Manasi, Jantam. It's very well known. Samani Va, Koti, Samani Radhyani Va. Well, that sort of socialistic message that we have in the Rig Veda, you cannot find in any of the writings of the world literature. So individual transformation, social transformation, about the Rashtra. We had many Rajyas, but only one Rashtra was there. We made a distinction between Rajya and Rashtra. And the Rashtra, or means Rashtra, stands for a cultural unity, which is of course quasi-geographical, but basically it is cultural. And its schemas of value schema should be there to be adhered to in a particular Rashtra. And we had a value schema, we call it Purushartha, Dharma, Earth, Kama, and Moksha. We are familiar only with the names. The details perhaps we may not know, but the threadbare discussion of Purusharthas is there. Literally, the word Purusharth means Pure Agre Sarati, that which moves ahead, that which enhances, evolves, develops, progresses. That is Purusha. So, and what is the objective of Purusha, Earth, Purusharth? Well, detailed discussion we have. And in this Purusharth analysis, we have taken care of both Priyas as well as Shreyas. Earth and Kam for Priyas, and Dharma and Moksha for Shreyas. So, about, I am very sketchy, but details are there. About political organization also, we have very rich literature. And the ruler has to take into account the well-being of the ruled. So Kautilya therefore begins his Arthashastra with his prajas, okay? So come Ragyaha. And for that, a ruler has to ensure that there is a good cultivation, production of food grains, but subsidiaries for the production of food grains. So we have how rivers are to be made properly used of, how cows and bullocks are to be made use of, how cow dung is to be made use of, and no such fertilizers which we have these days. Kautilya has not approved, because he says that all such means for production should be governed by yoga kshema. These are the two criteria. You must supplement the resources, augment the resources, and not to deplete the resources. This is yoga. And kshema, protect. You have to protect them so that they are not destroyed. And renewal, of course, you should also take care of. Production also, you should take care of. And then how to cultivate, what to cultivate, when to cultivate. Well, Kautilya gives detailed account of that. It's good for farmers. Well, I think the Pusa Institute people should read Arthashastra of Kautilya for that purpose. And then after production, distribution. So commerce, trade, industry will come under production only. Commerce and trade. Well, commerce and trade should not have profit motive. They should have service motive. They are meant to serve, not to earn profit. These days, it is the profit motive which governs all our economic enterprises. The entire economic order or planning that we have borrowed from the West is based on profit only. The present economic order is individualistic. It is divisive between the haves and have not, or the, to use communist phraseology, the bourgeoisie and the proletariat. It is exploitative. It is depriving. Some people get benefit of it, majority is deprived of it. And it is competitive, therefore cutthroat competition is there, leading to all sorts of manipulations. Well, this is the pattern that we have these days. Our ancient mode of doing economics, we have forgotten. Again, we have to go back to Kautilya for this purpose, is Arthashastra. Likewise, we have a sort of a democratic mode of thinking, democratic mode of behaving. We have been told, and this is a very famous statement from the Rigveda, ekam sadvipra bahudha vadanti. Reality is the same, but different people may approach it differently and may describe it differently. So therefore we must have respect for others' viewpoints also. We may agree, we may disagree, but we should agree to disagree if we disagree. This is democracy in ideas. This is what Rigvedic thinkers have inculcated. And therefore, they have developed a particular mode of philosophizing called Vada Vidhi. We have many treatises on Vada Vidhi, but unfortunately, again, we are not familiar with those treatises. In ICPR, in my organization, we are now planning to revive that mode of doing vada. Because we have this famous saying, vade vade jayate tattva bodha. This is very famous, that only through mutual give and take and through debate and discussion, you can achieve the truth, real knowledge of reality. So we therefore have, we do have a cultural homogeneity, at the same time, cultural accommodation. There must be national unity. Philosophers have always emphasized national unity, national integration. But in that, there must be accommodation for diversity. So, as I said earlier also, Nija and Para, we do have other. But it is not external other, it is internal other. There's a difference between external other and external other means something which is outside it and therefore to be separated and subsequently denied as well if need be. But internal means we take it to be our own part and parcel. So Rigvedic thinkers used to say about thought that let noble thoughts come to us from all over the world, but they should not make us blow away. We must be firmly footed in our own soil. That is, national unity has to be there, but we must welcome ideas coming from others. Similarly, we have welcomed people coming from others. Multinationalities, we have always welcomed. But those multinationals should not overpower us, should not subdue us, as East India Company did. That is something which we have to avoid. So, in our applied philosophy dimension, we have taken care of a legal aspect, political aspect, economic aspect, social aspect, cultural aspect, and we have a rich literature in all this available to us, but unfortunately it is in Sanskrit and in Pali and in Prakrit. And many of us are not competent to approach these texts which are available. Some of them are published. Some of them have been translated also in English. But many of them are in the form of manuscripts. And those which are translated, for example, Arthashastra of Kautilya has been translated by 2-3 scholars, Indian as well as foreigners. But best translation and exposition is by Kangle, which is available. So it's a marvelous work to be studied. My point, therefore, is that Indian mode of philosophizing has its own distinctive character. It is widespread. It touches all the domains of our life and existence, not only human, but all other domains, whether it is the empirical world or the transcendental spiritual world, which we have through yoga, or whether it is this earth or the terrestrial spheres. We had very developed astronomy. Astrology, of course, is for the worldly purposes, but astronomy we had developed, mathematics we had developed. Well, all these disciplines are there. Unfortunately, we are not familiar then, or even if, and see, we do not have self-recognition. I think you use the word self-recognition. We have to recognize our own self, what we are, what we should be. And and this self-recognition should come from our own. We have some element of self-recognition by Western Indologists. Western Indologists have told us that you have this thing, you have that thing. The German Indologists, French Indologists. But we ourselves, and when they recognize, then we also recognize. We also have that thing. It's not a matter of pride. It's a matter of getting benefit and advantage of the rich treasure that we have. But then competence is required. And for that competence, we should have a suitable system of education. Otherwise, how can we approach this valuable treasure? In ICPR, we are trying our best for philosophy, but for other social sciences also. I have written a monograph for ICSSR. It is being published by them now. Indian Council for as to how there should be Indian paradigm for doing social science research. Because our social scientists, they are grappling with the alien problems, alien methodology, alien physiology, alien conclusions they just borrow and adopt. Well, they don't have their own understanding of things and situations. 90% of the research work done in Indian Council of Social Science Research is of that type. And the present chairman is alive to that and he's trying his best now to revise the trend. This is a situation. In fact, our intellectuals have become flunkyist. We do not have our own understanding of our own situation. Always we borrow, we look to the West, we look to America, look to Europe, etc. We have a rich heritage. Of course, I don't say that we should deprive ourselves from their learning, from their expertise. We should borrow whatever is there, true, good and beautiful in them. But we should also stand on our own feet. One famous contemporary Indian thinker, K.C. Bhattacharya, has written a paper, Swaraj in Ideas. We don't have Swaraj in our ideas. We are not Swatantra, we are Partantra. In political independence we have, but we don't have intellectual independence so far. So this is what I think I have. Of course, my presentation has been sketchy because Indian philosophy is so very deep, so very wide and varied that you cannot deal with it in its totality. Only sketchy treatment can be provided. But it is really very rich and something which needs to be attended to. Thank you very much.
Thank you.